more.
Yeah.
I mean, I'll sit over here. So.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Rule of thumb, just.
Okay, yeah.
Now we're going live on the phone.
Oh, yeah, perfect.
Do you want to just
keep
boots down there?
Yeah, whatever. Then I can just grab them and
check into
this.
Which are going to be like literally the least thing we talk about.
Oh, alright.
It's going to be
BHA. Okay.
Man, okay. Are you okay with that?
Yeah, I wasn't sure which direction you want to go with it. So.
Well, I think based on what you said, you prefer BHA.
I mean, I can talk all day on either, so.
People have their boots, sorry.
Okay.
We'll talk about them. We'll promote them. It's your business. So we'll get that out there. But
yeah. I mean, and I'm blowing out the total later. So right now people are calling like, hey, I pulled my, they're from Alabama or Connecticut. I pulled my first elk tag. What kind of boots do I need? That's the fun shit for me.
Yeah.
I like talking about that stuff. Warranty claims, but I can get old.
Mm-hmm. Are you
going
to ramp your own show tonight? Do you want me to do it?
No, you ramp
that. Yeah.
We
can talk BHA stuff. That's fine.
I prefer it.
And for podcasts about BHA, I
can talk
about that.
You guys do like that.
Freezer with Seth is on live right now. You can go to Facebook, you can go to Facebook, or you can go to the app and you can watch or listen. It depends on what you want to do. So
we're having some trouble with Instagram right now. So if any of our listeners are up on Instagram, we're just having some minor malfunction. And if you're old enough to know this reference from Han Solo in Star Wars, we're fine. Everything's fine. How are you? We'll get there. But thank you for following us. And thank you, everybody, for the literally, we had north of 200,000 views on our show from 2 weeks ago with Boss Shot Shells. So I want to do just a quick shout out to Lee and Luke and the whole crew over at Boss. We love you guys. Thank you for everything. I think they're going to come back on right before duck opener. So if anybody was listening that picked up some of their shells and patterned and has any questions before duck opener, pheasant opener, goose opener, I know everything is kind of really co-mingled right there in September. Feel free to hit us up because I think they're going to come on about mid-September right before duck opener. We also did a little bit of talk on salamis, sopressata. I'm about to start cold smoking some of my bacon that I have in the refrigerator. But circling out most people, Utah, Idaho, Colorado, New Mexico, even Minnesota elk hunt, you guys have probably received your tags. And now you're looking at your gear and you're thinking, oh crap, what do I need? I've mentioned this on the show before. I do not promote any product that I've never tried before. We have a special guest tonight to talk about a little bit of some of the gear, but I also want him to get into the organization that he's a member of. But to circle back on the gear, if you are thinking, oh crap, right now, get on it. Get on your gear. Try it out. We have a couple of things that we're going to put up on the video. Hopefully, if you have any questions, feel free. Chime in. Facebook, Instagram, call into the radio network. We'll get some of your questions answered if we can. Because now's the time, because it's literally zero dark 30 for you to get your gear in line. To move forward, I want to introduce our guest, and I want him to, give us, like a 30-second background of BHA.
Okay.
And we will do the boots and gear later, but I want to focus on BHA for now. And because two episodes ago, we talked about the MBRB and that organization. So I want you to introduce your organization, what you do, how you do it, what's important, and how we can help.
Okay. So my name is Aaron Haybison. I'm part of the Minnesota chapter of Backcountry Hunters and Anglers.
So BHA.
Yes. Short note of BHA. And so BHA is a nationwide organization, originally started out of Oregon around a campfire. Based on a lack of, these guys stood around the fire and said, there's duck groups, there's pheasant groups, there's elk groups, there's deer groups, but there's no one focusing specifically on the land that we can go. And
sure.
Frankly, if we don't have the land there, it doesn't matter if the animals are there to hunt or not. So they said we need a group specifically to focus on public land and access to it. We've got about 40,000 members plus nationwide, and here in Minnesota we've got about 1,600 members. I sit on that state chapter board here in Minnesota.
How do you think we can increase BHA's numbers in Minnesota specifically? Because I get nationwide you have 40,000 members. Like, I've been a member of Ducks Unlimited, Minnesota Waterfowl Association, Pheasant Forever. I get they have a national footprint. Are you guys doing charity events? Are you doing banquets? Are you doing giveaways? Or are you just mainly like an online presence? What can we tell our listeners now to get them to go and view and click and be part of a membership to get it involved?
Sure.
Where can we direct them?
Yeah. So our website is backcountryhunters.org. And so there you can go and sign up for a membership. It'd be similar to some of the other conservation organizations that you'd be maybe more familiar with. But, some of those other species-specific, I guess I would call them organizations, would focus on restoration, habitat, whereas we do a lot more political advocacy. So it's talking to legislators, talking to representatives, kind of banging on doors at town hall meetings, and making a local presence.
So are you guys advocating for, CRP, for pheasant hunting, and also are you advocating for, public land ownership for deer hunting? So you guys aren't game specific.
No,
you're
correct.
Land
yep,
specific.
Absolutely.
And okay. That's so one, I want you to talk about that.
Yeah, and that's one, I guess, big draw that our organization can have. You don't have to specifically be even a hunter or angler.
Right.
Obviously, that's where we're coming from. That's where.
But
I'm
if you are,
from.
You can reach multiple hunters. That okay? So you have a guy who's a pheasant hunter, or a guy who's a deer hunter. Well. What BHA does is it benefits both.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Or whether you are hiker, paddler, camper, berry picker, you can join this organization because we're advocating for those lands. There's 640 million acres of public land, federally managed public land in this country that you and I and someone in Arizona all have the same ability to access, whether you're a doctor or a teacher or a high school kid.
Yeah. I think there's kind of like a wave of public landowners, and I want to say that to the camera, public landowners that hunt, that really want to get involved with organizations like this. And I think BHA has a really good macro niche in the sense that they're not species specific, whereas like Minnesota Waterfowl Association, Pheasants Forever, you want to go to National Wild Turkey Federation, you want to go to all these other, you can go to them and they're going to try and angle their dollars for that specific species, where BHA is just naturally looking for public land.
Yeah.
And expanding that for not only hunters and conservationists, but environmentalists and outdoors people, whether you want to carry a paddle for your kayak or a gun over your shoulder.
Absolutely.
So I think if you want to expand on just like the public access, I think that can reach more people versus, hey, if you're not a gun-toter duck hunter, then we don't want you.
Right.
That's not what BHA stands for.
Right. No, not at all. Yeah. I mean, something that we, I think, have an advantage, we're very generalist. You and I both hunt multiple species.
Sure.
And we're not focusing on just deer. I know those hardcore deer hunters, and that's their thing. Mm-hmm. And hats off to them. But
yeah.
I'm way too antsy and ADD to focus on one species throughout my entire seasons.
You can't just focus on November 1st through the 8th.
Yes.
You want to go hiking, berry picking. If you want to go out and explore the natural resources and you want to protect that, where does BHA come involved with, like, the state or the federal government? How do they do that?
Sure. So, for example, recently... have you guys talked about the Great American Outdoors Act much?
So we referenced that probably every episode since
okay.
it came out.
Okay.
And I don't want to make it political, but it is very, very beneficial to the American public that we have secured more acreage in the last, I think it was signed a month ago?
Yeah, about that.
Maybe about a month and a half ago. We have secured more land, for public access, since Teddy Roosevelt.
Yeah, right. Well, and that's what's, again, nice about this organization is it's by law, we are 501c3. We cannot advocate for a certain party or another.
Sure.
We're by law bipartisan.
Beautiful.
And that's how it's supposed to be. Like,
yeah.
Conservation issues should not be red or blue.
No.
So.
It's green.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. Like.
Yeah.
Whether, like you said, you want to be...
And brown
paddle.
In the fall.
Yeah, exactly. Whether
yeah.
you want to have a paddle or
mm-hmm.
a gun or a bow or trekking poles, like, go out and use it for anybody. And
yeah.
that's what Great American Outdoors Act did, was secure funding for Land and Water Conservation Fund across
so
the country.
How does BHA then further that? Because obviously that was a national mandate, right? How does BHA then take that mandate and inform local hunters, kayakers, hikers, hunters, how do they do that? What's the advantage of BHA over somebody just reading the Star Tribune and, oh, great, we have more land.
Cool,
like,
right.
What is...
So something that BHA does differently on the local scale is with some other groups. So with some other groups, it might be, everybody has banquets. Everybody knows about... You know, there's a banquet, you pay your X amount of membership for a year, and somebody goes to a banquet, and maybe you see that organization locally
once a year,
twice a year.
Yeah, and you spend $300 on raffle tickets, and one guy wins five guns,
right.
and you go home with your tail between your legs.
Yep.
How is that different? How is BHA different than that?
So our organization, being nationwide, and we don't have state, like, localized chapters or regional chapters like... you might see in other organizations. So we have, if you email minnesota@backcountryhunters.org, you are going to reach the board members for the whole state. So that gives us the ability to be very unified in our message, whether you're in Bemidji or Pipestone or Duluth or Rochester. And that message is going to be amplified across the state. And it also gives us the ability to go, okay, we're going to, instead of doing these one, you know, banquet a year, mm-hmm. we do what's called like pint nights or fly tying events or storytelling events, different things to engage maybe not specifically hook and bullet crowd.
Sure.
Because they're going to get more outdoors advocates into the room and kind of try and meet people where they're at. Rather
so
than
how is a guy's, how is a guy or a wife or whomever up in Bemidji, where is, because I see this all the time with waterfowl. People here in Minnesota hate spending money on waterfowl because they think everybody in the South shoots their ducks. They hate putting money into a National Wild Turkey Federation that doesn't benefit them directly. How does BHA manage their finances in order for somebody in Bemidji, Duluth, New Prague, Minnesota, Austin, Albert Lea, how do they feel about, how does BHA manage that money? Do they do a local management and then a national management? Because I got to tell you, if I'm going to spend my money, I would like for it to be spent locally.
Right.
How does BHA handle
that? For sure. And we've gone through some recent shifts in the best way to manage that. We've seen it on one side where everything goes to the mothership and nothing gets spent locally and you don't really have any power locally. And we've seen it to where the local chapter might hoard and hoard and hoard and their bank accounts are stacked. When the one the next county over has nothing, and so they just sit on it. Well, that doesn't help the major organization either. So right now we're a 50-50 split.
So let me ask you like a question where I sit. I guess my idea is if we can spend more money in Minnesota and Missouri, Arkansas, Mississippi, if they receive more ducks or Canada receives more breeding ground, I'm okay with that because I want more ducks.
Sure.
And I may not get to harvest those ducks, but guess what? Some kid down in Arkansas does, and now he's a hunter, and now his dad is spending money on duck stamps and guns and camo and contributing to just the whole discipline. So I'm not an isolationist.
Right.
Where I would love if I spent $500 in Minnesota, and if you want to equate that to duck kills, if one kid down in Arkansas kills two ducks and now he's hooked for life, then I've done my job because him, his father, his uncles, his sisters, his mom, they're going to spend money traveling around and doing the whole deal. So I don't get all wrapped around the axle about where the money goes. As long as it goes to an area that promotes habitat, reproduction, and then also promotes hunter education, not just for hunters, but for the public.
Yeah.
So where does BHA stand on environment, where the money goes, how that is spent, and do they have like an angle right now, and where is like the 2-3-5 year plan?
Sure. Yeah. I mean, so I think the advocacy direction and just what you were saying, like it doesn't have to be whether you might go there at some point. I might never go and hunt the Bridger Range of Montana, but
I just won't.
Yeah, right.
But I mean, I'd like to give money that would help that.
Yeah, right. Because somebody at some point will.
Right.
And from the flip side, I know people who are not going to go to the Boundary Waters.
Sure.
But they could.
Yeah.
The fact is, it's accessible. It's open. They have the ability, and if it's just even the idea that some little old lady in New Jersey can, if she wants and has the willpower to do so and the physical ability, that she can throw a canoe on her back and go and hit the Boundary Waters, like, that's what it's there for. That's what our angle is,
yeah.
is to try and keep those open for that solace and manpower ability to go and hit it.
So if I was going to ask you what the BHA was going to do, like, let's just say 2021. Let's leave 2020 in the fucking dust. What is BHA's goal in 2021? Like, what do you guys want to accomplish? How do you get there? And how can we help people contribute to your guys' goal?
I mean, I think our big focus right now is a lot of, weeding our way through this mess that is the 2020 and election season. And so our big push right now coming up, starting in September, September is known as Public Lands Month.
Mm-hmm.
So we're going to be doing a huge push in September and the following months.
When you say huge push, what do you mean by that?
So huge push to vote public lands and waters. And that just means, again, not advocating for a certain party, one side or another, but taking into account...
Encouraging people to...
Like, hey, when you're going to go to the ballot box, thinking about those public lands, waters, places, whether it's the Boundary Waters or the San Juans in Colorado or the Everglades, you know, it's putting those things front of center of mind. Like, those are important enough to me to vote, you know, my policies with that at the top of my priorities.
So if you have a national... voter box, and you have to check one box or the other, and you're an environmentalist, they may be all for the Everglades, but you'll never go to the Everglades, but maybe let's check that box to help the Everglades.
Yeah,
is that what BHA is for? I think every hunter, we've had dwindling numbers for probably two generations. I think every hunter now is an environmentalist, but it's also a double-edged sword. I think local hunters have become more protectionist about their private lands that they hunt, their lease lands, it's HRLBO, it's like hunter rental land by owner. It's like an Airbnb for hunting land.
Okay.
Now is that's becoming a thing. And there is, Minnesota isn't South Dakota where it's $100 a gun a day per person, but I can see the protectionist happening because there's less and less and less public land. What do you see BHA getting involved with our state, Minnesota, getting involved to expand public land?
So we worked with Pheasants Forever last my months are all jumbled together, but in February we announced that we worked with Pheasants Forever and a pile of other partners to introduce the Cupido Wildlife Management Area.
Where's that at? For our listeners that may not know, where's that at?
West Central Minnesota.
What's the nearest big city you can throw out there for?
Oh, gosh.
Marshall?
Yeah, I know it's
Benson.
North of, yeah, I think so.
Okay.
Don't quote me on it.
No, it's fine. Yeah, I'm just trying to give geographical reference to some of our listeners.
Yep.
But go ahead. So you partnered with Pheasants Forever, trying to get some more public land, which is amazing. What do you feel like BHA has the biggest pushback? Is it from... lack of funding, lack of political leadership, lack of membership? What can we do to help out BHA moving forward to get more land?
If I'm talking to people about BHA and I'm standing up at a pint night and talking to people, I mean, there's always three things. My first thing, obviously, yes, join, become a member.
Mm-hmm.
We'd love the money. That's wonderful. Every organization, especially
what does
right
it cost
now,
to join?
It's $35 to join for an individual membership. Pretty standard across... the board, you know, similar to others.
And I would challenge anybody listening to this right now, if you've ever been out to a happy hour and spent more than $40, you're about right there.
Yep.
It's a happy hour to join BHA and further your cause.
Yeah, right.
Sorry to interrupt, but continue.
I mean, so $35 to join individual membership for the year. So, yes, the money's wonderful. Every conservation organization right now would love to have the extra dollars.
Mm-hmm.
The next thing is your time. And whether that's, and so like I said, a lot of it, instead of habitat restoration or the focus on gaining more lands, a lot of it is that time to write a letter to a senator, make a phone call for Great American Outdoors Act.
So is that
tag them on social media and say, hey, help us protect the boundary waters.
Sure. Like, and I think a lot of people, all the things that you've talked about are... what normal environmentalists, conservationists would do, what is there, like, a time requirement? Like, so for example, if you want to join like a gun range, a lot of times you have to donate 8 hours twice a year to be the range marshal or do cleanup or whatever. Does BHA require you to give your time for anything?
Nope.
Other than your initial investment?
Nope.
Okay.
I mean, if you want to be the dues-paying member, you pay once a year, you get your 4 quarterly journals, and that's it. Like, we appreciate it. Thank you very much. But we encourage you to come and join us at more of those events. Public Lands Day at the Capitol, range days, fly tying events, these storytelling events. Like, we're all volunteer. Everybody on the board, no one's getting paid for that.
Yeah.
Like, it's just how much time do you want to commit to that thing? And my guess is, if you're like the rest of my board with myself, you're going to enjoy it enough that you want to go and do those things.
So would it be fair to say that the BHA is not asking more of you? It's just asking you to do what you would already normally do, just under the banner of BHA.
Totally. Like,
yeah,
in your own circles,
yep,
is to go out and help at your own deer camp and sitting around that poker table or out on the boat that you're already going to go out on. Have a conversation that's, you know, maybe beyond that just, you know, how big were those antlers kind of talk.
Yeah. So I think that there's, in my opinion, there is a fundamental shift of hunters that want to conserve. And there's another group of hunters that just want to, sorry to be morbid, they just want to kill.
Sure.
And I think BHA is a conduit for individuals that want to conserve for the future. They want to leave seed for the following generations.
Yep.
And I think that sometimes in some family groups, in extended family groups, that conservation can be lost through the killing. And I think BHA is a really good conduit to at least just have that conversation. And if you get one or two members in a hunting group talking about conservation through BHA, I think it can further that through younger generations. So where does BHA stand on trying to grab the younger generation of hunter, fisherman, outdoorsman? Like, where, I know you said you have your pint talks and fly tying. Like, can you expand a little bit more on that and kind of tell our listeners what they can go to bring their young daughter or son to and maybe get them excited about?
Yeah, absolutely. So last year, for example, we have our national rendezvous. It's kind of like our national convention that happens usually out west. There's a lot more public lands out west.
Where out west are you talking?
So last year it was in Boise.
Okay.
This year it was supposed to be in Missoula, which is where BHA headquarters is based out of, but COVID canceled things.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's the national convention. We had our state rendezvous up in Staples last summer. We tried to centralize it as much as possible,
sure,
so anybody from anywhere in the state could try and get there.
They're within, like, 2 hours.
Yes, exactly, pretty much.
About.
Yep.
Yep.
And so we had everything from, you know, the standard kind of raffles and a wild game cook-off feed to, you know, having we had kids crawl into paper bags. We brought a bunch of paper bags.
Fun.
And said, you know what, let's, how did these hunting stories get started? And we went back to kind of the caveman days. Like,
yeah,
how did they tell stories? So we had kids crawl into these paper bags with crayons and markers, and they drew their caveman stories on the inside of these cave walls.
Sure.
And that was, like, to help them tell their hunting stories. And you had kids drawing, you know, obviously fishing rods and deer with the antlers that are this big. Like,
that's, no, that's cool
that
BHA brings an environment around for kids to get involved, because hunter, fishermen, conservationists, we've been dwindling for a generation. And I think we have a real opportunity to get people involved. We got to get them involved young. But as parents, if you're not a hunter or a fisherman, but you may want to get your kid involved in the outdoors, is BHA somewhere that they can feel like, hey, I'm not a big hunter, but I want to get my kid exposed to it. Is BHA some environment that would be welcoming to somebody like that?
Definitely.
It's,
I'll be honest, we haven't done as much kid-based stuff as some other organizations. Four Corns camps, the Woodies,
the Woodies, you know, yeah,
I mean,
there's
Green Wings,
other
organizations that focus a lot more on the youth aspect, whereas something that we're seeing, and we're in kind of a unique position to try and connect with people from that maybe non-hook and bullet background, is we go and meet them and start talking about food. Heck, everybody eats. So we talk about some of these things from a food aspect, but we're going to talk to the adults, because it's those kids that we're going to try and get in, a lot of those kids that might be interested in hunting and fishing, chances are it's because their parents already do it.
Yeah.
So we're going to try and reach out to those adults who don't. They're going to have a more stable financial ability to come and maybe try.
Well, their parents are the ones that are going to be contributing financially.
Right. Or drive time.
Adults.
Yeah. I mean, getting adults out hunting and fishing. There's adults that are interested. We found them. They come to us in droves and say, who's willing to take me? Like, I can drive to a trailhead.
They just want to learn.
Yeah. So let's teach those people. We focus a lot on that contingent.
So would it be fair to say that BHA is more concerned at this point? Let's teach the adults that will teach the further generations so we can grow exponentially from our current adult base.
Yes, I would say that's fair, for sure.
Okay, so if you're an adult and you want to get involved and you want to find like a safe space to try your hand at duck hunting, goose hunting, pheasant hunting, whatever, how are they going to find BHA? Either online or over the phone, like, can you give us a little bit, you know, just plug yourself, plug BHA right now.
Yeah. So the Minnesota chapter has our own social media channels, Minnesota chapter of Backcountry Hunters and Anglers on Facebook, BHA_MN at Instagram. And then the larger organization as a whole is Backcountry Hunters and Anglers on Facebook and Backcountry Hunters at Backcountry Hunters on Instagram. Those are, I mean, probably the most common ways, I guess, the easiest, fastest.
Yeah,
ways.
And we've tagged you.
And
we
can do, I mean, emails, like I said, you send an email to minnesota@backcountryhunters.org. There are like two or three people from our chapter leadership that are going to get that email. And I would say
somebody
within a couple of days, you're going to get a response.
Okay, that's awesome, because I really do feel like there's a lot of individuals out there that are just nervous.
Yeah.
Well, they want to get involved, and I think there's some sentiment out there that my family didn't hunt, I don't have an uncle that hunts, and you can't crack the code to get into this deer hunting group. It's daunting. It's intimidating.
For sure.
So I think BHA is a really good place to start if you want to get involved, if you want your kids to get involved. Go to our Facebook page. Go to our Instagram page. We've tagged BHA. Just, if nothing less, just, you know, spend 10, 15 minutes reading about BHA and what they stand for. And you don't have to hunt. You don't have to fish. You can just be an outdoorsman. If you want to get involved in being an environmentalist, you can get involved in BHA and learn about what they do to contribute to furthering outdoor, outspace, non-pressure, environmentalist activities.
We're actually trying to work with a little bit with the DNR, and this is still kind of in the chalkboard stages, but I believe it's MN Mentor Network. And so if you're somebody who is just like looking to try and get into it, you go to this website, you go, I'm looking to try and start hunting. And then it'll say, okay, what type of hunting are you looking to do? And it'll show you the mentors for that type of activity that are interested, that are statewide. And they're already mentors who have volunteered and said, I'm interested in taking some new people up, and those people can come find me.
Or you can have a conversation with that person and just learn a little bit of the four corners of the document.
Yeah, exactly.
So since we started doing the show, I've had a few people reach out to me about, like, gear and, you know, hey, I want you to, like, build me out a gear system. And honestly, like, I'm not into that in so much as, like, promoting a specific gear. I just want to know what you're about, how you want to do it. Like, if you just want to meander around, great. I'll tell you to wear this. And that, 'cause that's worked for me. If you're a hardcore hunter, you know, You already have your own ideas, but I encourage you to challenge your own ideas and go to BHA and try and look at some of the new fundamentals that are going around, because the days of, you know, just going to buy a duck stamp over the counter and throwing on some camo, that's, I think hunting is, and fishing has come a long way. We're past just getting in a boat and trying to kill some ducks. We're trying to save some ducks and build some ducks. We're trying to save some deer and build some deer so we have more deer to kill for our kids, our nephews. And if you don't want to hunt, if you don't want to fish, understand that conservation helps everybody. And being an environmentalist doesn't mean you have to be anti-hunting. And if you want to be an environmentalist and promote public land, BHA is still a place where you can go to help an organization buy public land.
Yeah, right.
Is that fair?
We don't do a ton of buying. I mean, like I said, the Cupido was one of the first places actually in the country that we actually put dollars down to purchase public land. But it's a lot of it's that preservation of what's already there. We don't have as bad issues in Minnesota, but for example, and I use Wyoming as my flagship issue. If you are floating a river, let's say in Wyoming, and you cast a line and you get snagged on shore, and a landowner owns up, you know, you've got landowner A and landowner B, private land on both mm-hmm. sides, and you get snagged on the shore, well, you're trespassing.
Yep.
Now you're trespassing because they own up to the center line of that river. Yep. And if you take a step or drop an anchor, you're trespassing on someone's private land. It's the same way on a road. If you get out of your vehicle to go and stalk an antelope in a ditch, if it's not public land, you're trespassing.
Yeah.
And we have excellent water access here in Minnesota. But knowing and trying to help share out that, look at some of these other places, they could be a lot worse. And we, if we're not careful, it could turn into that.
Well, and I think that goes back to what I was saying earlier about like $100 a gun a day per hunter. Like out in South Dakota, pheasant hunting, it's like, we don't want to turn Minnesota into that.
Right.
We want to promote education about public land, how to do it safely, and how to promote public land ownership. And I think BHA is a conduit to get that. If there's, I'm a member of Pheasant Forever, Minnesota Wildfowl Association, Ducks Unlimited, but there in those mechanisms, they don't have, yeah, they buy land, but they don't tell you how to hunt public land and promote public land ownership. They just say, oh, we bought 100,000 acres of swamp land out in Marshall, Minnesota. Well, great. That's awesome. I really appreciate that. But they really don't do anything to promote duck hunting other than like maybe the green wing little mechanism that they have. It's just, come here, spend $300 on raffle tickets, and
yeah.
That's about it.
Right.
Like, the communication is very, very limited. So where does BHA stand on communicating with public land owners and conservationists, hunters, fishermen, hikers? Where do they stand on promoting how to do what you want to do versus trying to grab your money?
Sure. I mean, and that's the beauty of us being a statewide organization is when I go out to a pint night in Duluth and I get to talk to people in Duluth and shake your hand and say, hey, nice to meet you. Let's hear about your stuff that's going on in your area. And then in 6 months, when there's some local town hall meeting about no net gain and, you know, their issue, you know, they can go, okay, I met Aaron.
Yeah.
I met that guy.
Yep.
Tell me about, let's call him, he can get a hold of the board, and they can put something, pen to paper.
And we can come there and have a conversation about
yes.
it.
Right. We did that out in Black Paparo County.
Sure.
There was an issue there to yeah. where willing landowner, DNR wanted to buy the land, and the county board said, nope, you know what, we've got enough public land in this area, we're basically putting a veto on this, and the private landowner in that area, as well as BHA members from that area, reached out to us and said, hey, is this something you'd be willing to get on board with? We said, absolutely. So we contacted other sporting organizations in the state to get behind us with this. We contacted Minnesota Outdoor Heritage Association. We contacted the legislators and the DNR and the biologists in that area. and we, you know, put a letter out to the managers, the wildlife managers in that area, as well as that county board, and said, we see what you're doing, knock it off.
Yeah. So would it be fair to say that BHA can be an advocate for local and national land growth publicly?
Yeah, absolutely. That's exactly what we're here for. We're the state chapter.
So you're just not a money grabber to buy land that nobody will ever hunt.
Right.
You guys are here also to advocate on your behalf. So, for example, we probably have some up north listeners that, you know, are like on the Iron Range or whatever. And they're like, well, there's plenty of public land, but we see the Iron Range kind of creeping in and they want to mine over here. Would BHA be somebody that they could call and maybe get somebody to advocate on their behalf?
Totally.
To keep it public versus turn it private.
Definitely. I mean, and it's, I want
to without
stress
going
this.
To a banquet and spending $300.
Yes, absolutely. And I want to stress that we are, yes, I mean, I come at it from a hook and bullet environmentalist. Like,
same,
I want to keep those things accessible for everyone because I like to hunt and fish them.
Mm-hmm.
We are not anti-extraction.
Yeah.
This, I mean, those public lands are there for multiple use,
mm-hmm.
whether you are logging, hunting, fishing, mining.
But let's be responsible.
I love mining.
Like, let's mine it.
Absolutely.
That's fine, but let's be responsible about it.
And there are places that do not deserve to be mined.
And there's also places
that
deserve to be mined.
Absolutely.
So,
log.
And I'm,
logging
is great.
Absolutely.
Logging helps deer management.
Totally.
It really does.
And there's absolutely areas that should be mined, for sure.
There's areas that should be burned to the ground. Like, literally burn it.
We wouldn't be able to be talking on this mechanism right now without the copper and nickel that is in these wires.
That's right. And I think that, like, you know, a field burn is helpful from time to time. And I think that there, if you wanted to contact the Department of Interior, they would agree.
Yep.
Let's let some of these fires burn themselves out, and the regrowth is better for the environment.
Right.
And I understand that there's like a knee-jerk reaction to mining, to logging, to fire burning, and I'm not against any of that. I just want everything to be done responsibly. But I don't want to have to go to a Ducks Unlimited banquet and spend $300 and nobody knows my name and not be heard about, you know, hey, can we get some wood duck houses over in Stillwater, Minnesota, along the river, which is where they should all be, by the way. You know, I don't want to have to do that, where if we could get BHA on board to talk to the DNR, is BHA in a position to be a broker between a landowner, private citizen like myself, to contact the DNR in the, you know, Washington County District and say, hey, I think, you know, we would really advocate for 200 wood duck houses along the bluffs in Stillwater. How can we get that done? And if the DNR says we'll come up with $5,000, then maybe we could talk about having a banquet, but would the BHA be the person I could call to try and maybe have a larger voice with the DNR? Because if I call my local DNR guy, he's going to tell me to pound sand.
Yeah. I mean, there's organizations that are out there that are going to be the ones who want to put, you know, boots on the ground and build those duck houses.
Mm-hmm.
And if we're not that organization, we're damn sure going to find the ones who are. And yes, the land is what we're there for.
Yeah.
And if you guys got to find a spot to go and do it, hell yeah, we're going to help you find that spot. And that kind of brings me to the third thing that, you know, when I am talking at a pint night or, you know, storytelling event, what we need out of our members. So we talked about the money. Yes, that's wonderful. And the time, absolutely, to take a time to contact a legislator. But the third one is your voice.
Mm-hmm.
And that's really the biggest thing, and it's free. Like, to go and we need that voice.
But that's my point. Like,
I'm not gonna
like a guy like me, I could call my local DNR guy and he's going to tell me to pound sand. But if it comes from the BHA,
right,
I think it comes with a little heavier of a hammer, right?
Exactly. Like, that's the goal, is we're there to be your bullhorn. You're going to talk about it through us. Come to us. We're going to help you bullhorn that out there. Like with that Lacaparo situation, those local representatives, the BHA members in that area, didn't know how to go about it. So they contacted BHA to be that bigger voice, to have a little bit, like you said, heavier hammer.
And you've done it before.
Yeah.
You have contacts with the DNR. You have contacts with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife. You guys have seen this movie before.
Yes.
So if I have an issue, I can be a member of BHA, contribute my $35, and that will get me access to a bigger bullhorn.
Definitely.
Okay. So let me ask you this. What else other than access to a bigger bullhorn and the satisfaction of maybe contributing to a larger conservationist ethos, what else does BHA do that might be attractive to just like a weekend warrior?
Sure. I guess I'm thinking about it from someone like my wife, who, yeah, she'll go out and fish pretty casually. She doesn't hunt, but came from a hunting background. But something that attracts her is it's a different crowd. You're not looking at the same, maybe staler crowd that you would stereotypically think of in a conservation group. You can go and see people from all kinds of walks of life, all kinds of different backgrounds. And that's one thing that public land really kind of brings, like, whether you're a doctor or a teacher or a high school kid, anybody can do this.
Like we talked about earlier, BHA doesn't just stand for bullets and hooks.
Yes.
They stand for kayaks, canoes, paddles, water, hiking trails. So you aren't just going to a Ducks Unlimited banquet,
right,
for ducks.
Just for ducks.
You're going to an environmentalist crowd.
Yeah.
So,
right.
And I don't mean to answer the question for you.
When we go and, you know, see people at where they're at with, you know, local breweries or local parks, and we go do a storytelling with Filson, something like that, and we get to talk to people about what they're interested in, rather than having them go, okay, I'm only interested in ducks, and that's
yeah.
why I'm here. Okay, let's talk to you about what you're interested in and find the right spot to plug you in.
Well, you tell us what you're interested
yeah,
in,
right.
and we'll help you
yep.
with that versus us telling you.
Right.
So it's kind of an inverted relationship.
Right.
Like Ducks Unlimited, Pheasants Forever, they're species specific. BHA is the environment.
Right. And
yeah.
it lends itself to being we're active, we're younger, we're energetic.
Sure.
I mean, a lot of conservation organizations right now, their median age is 45 to 65. BHA is 25 to 45. I'm 30, and I'm one of the youngest guys on our membership, or one of the older guys, I take that back,
sure.
on our board.
So that's awesome. I know that a lot of our listeners have probably been members of Pheasants Forever, Ducks Unlimited, since they've been 12, since they went and got their firearms safety certificate. But what I want to do to some of our listeners is challenge them to be more of an active member, not only in those specific organizations. And I love Ducks Unlimited. I love Pheasants Forever. I love the National Wildlife Turkey Federation. But what I want to challenge some of our listeners to is to get involved just a little bit more than that, because public land and conservation and ownership of what we can do isn't just about bullets and hooks. Like, we need to be able to have accessibility for everybody, because if we all hunters and fishermen can't afford to buy this public land, guess what? Then let's call upon some of the kayakers, the hikers, the canoers, the campers, the DIY backpackers to get in there and contribute to an organization that will advocate for public land ownership. So duck hunters, pheasant hunters, deer hunters, we're not alone. There are other people out there that we can call upon to get some of this information across, money across, and let's not be so specific on what you do. And I get it. If you're a duck hunter, you're weird. you're a sadistic fuck.
I took it up last year. It's
yeah,
a different
it is.
For
yeah,
sure.
Yeah, yeah.
Last
yeah.
year was my first year.
You hate sleep. You hate sleep. You hate being warm. You love being wet and cold. But
yeah,
I love you.
I thought elk hunters were hardcore. And
so I'm a huge elk hunter. So I get it.
I got nothing.
I grew up as a duck hunter.
Waterfall guys.
Yeah, it's. I love all you guys, but let's expand our minds and try and get out there. So if nothing else, I'm not asking you to sign up and pay $35, but just go to their webpage, check it out. Just give them a little bit of traffic, look at what they have to offer, and if you don't like it, then you don't like it, and that's fine. That's absolutely. Put $35 into a case of Bush Light and stay at home with the wife and go duck hunting in the morning. That is awesome, and I love you for that too. So let's try and move on to one other subject. I am going out to Colorado elk hunting on Rifle One, and I think you're going out to Idaho.
Yep.
Recently.
Yep.
Or coming up in like 3 weeks. 3 weeks going out to Idaho. You also work for our setter, Red Wing-ish.
Yep.
You want to give us a little background on that? And I do want a little bit of gear talk here. I like gear. I'm not a advocate of one thing or the other. I do own multiple sets of Irish setters, but I want you to talk about what we have here, but I wanted you to talk about your hunt first.
Okay, yeah. So,
did you get drawn or over the counter?
Yeah, so it was over the counter.
Okay.
I had a guy reach out to me last fall, I think it was like November, and he's like, hey, I know you're interested in going out. So last year, I guess, backstory, I had gone out with a friend on his, it took him 8 years to draw this unit in Southwestern.
Oof.
As a resident, it took
Oof.
Him 8 years.
Oof.
As a non-resident, it would have taken me 14 years to draw
Oof.
This tag. And so he didn't get it at first. So I was just going to go, we were going to go over the counter, and I was just going to tag along.
Yep.
And, okay, great, yep, I'll learn what this whole elk hunting thing is about before I go.
Yeah.
And just, like, feet on my leg and don't know what I'm talking about and just like to waste a ton of time
sure.
out elk hunting. So I want to see how this plays out for him, fly on the wall, and I'll help you pack meat if I can. Like, that'd be the best
sure.
thing that can happen. So got a little taste of elk hunting.
You're out there for a camping
year.
Trip.
Yeah, basically.
Yep.
Yep. I had a pack on my back and he had a bugle too.
Okay.
But so then I kind of got the taste of it, had another buddy locally reach out and say, hey, do you want to go next year? I'm like, all right, man. Yeah, sure. Actually,
yeah.
It was my wife's boss's husband, who has been going for a while. I don't really know the guy that well at this point. And so he called
me. Does that make you nervous?
No, at that point, it kind of did.
Yeah.
But, I mean, like, I think our wives had done some hen clucking at that point and discussed. And it was like, you know, some wives will say, hey, maybe our husband should go play a round of golf. Or maybe they should go do a happy hour together. No, ours were both
oh,
like,
hey, I want to send my husband 800 miles away up
drive,
on a mountain.
Drive 28 hours together in a car. Go spend 10 days in a tent together. Try and kill an elk.
I've never met your wife, but she sounds awesome.
Yeah, right. She'll push you to the limit,
yeah.
for sure. So I'm like, all right, man, let's do this. He's like, by the way, we got 2 weeks, and it's over the counter. You got to be online at midnight December 1st.
Okay.
I'm like, okay, like, let's do this thing.
Yeah.
So I'm sitting there, midnight, December, you know, whatever, the last
yep.
day of November, and then I realize it's
refresh,
midnight.
Refresh, refresh, refresh.
It's midnight Idaho time.
Oh.
And I'm sitting here in Minnesota at midnight and went, nope.
You're an hour late.
No, hour
Two.
Early. I'm an hour
oh,
early.
Oh, early, yeah.
So
That's
I'm
right.
ahead of time.
Yeah.
And so I had to sit there for another hour.
So it's 1 a.m.
So it was 1 a.m. when I got to start hitting refresh.
Yeah.
And... you know, a few adult sodas
so
later.
So you got your, well,
and
we
was,
can call it whiskey if you want. That's fine.
Nope,
we can say
was,
whiskey on the air.
A six-pack of Bush Lights later.
Oh, blue smoothies.
Yep.
I think we love blue smoothies.
And it was 2:30 before I finally hit checkout. And so I finally got the tag, 2:30, and we
yeah.
pulled, we ended up with four of us getting the tag for that.
Good
area.
For you. Let me ask you for the listeners, what is a over-the-counter... it's obviously public information,
yep.
but what is a price point for an over-the-counter Idaho elk tag?
So, I think it was like $575.
Is that bull or
so
either
is,
or?
This is an either sex.
Okay.
This is an either sex tag. I can go out and it's
harvest
good
a cow
for, yep,
or
it's
a
good
bull.
For archery season. Yep.
So, for the listeners, a over-the-counter bull tag, Rifle One in Colorado is $680. So, it's fairly comparable,
yeah.
fairly comparable. In Colorado, you do get a fishing license with it. I don't know if Idaho adds on any mandatory.
No add-ons there.
Okay.
I know with that license, I think I could throw a wolf tag in my pocket for $30.
So that's awesome to know. I think a wolf tag for $30 would be worth it,
right.
Just to have it.
Just in case.
Have it, not need it, need it, not, you know, yeah, what, right. You know what I mean? But in Colorado, you can add on a bear tag for $100. I think a mountain lion tag, I think it's $250 extra,
okay.
Which is a super expensive trip.
Right.
Particularly if you're doing doing it yourself.
Right.
Because you're already paying for either hotels, food, driving out there. So how are you guys going to be hunting in Idaho? Tell me about, are you hunting public land? Are you doing a drop camp, a spike camp, an outfitter, a full boat? Like,
Yep. This is
tell our listeners about
like
what you're doing.
Public land.
I've never been to Idaho, so I want you to...
Yeah,
talk
this is my first trip to Idaho, too. It's actually my first out-of-state archery tag.
Okay.
So we are doing totally over-the-counter public land, piled into a car. We have a pull-behind trailer that we're going to load coolers and tents and everything in, and then stay on public land.
Mm-hmm.
I think what we're planning on doing is we've got a few spots mapped out in our area that we're going to kind of centralize our camp somewhat within those, and then go, okay, I think today we're going to hit this area, and if it tanks, okay, we're going to try another area.
Horses or no horses?
All feet.
All
packs on our back.
So you're in a wilderness area with no motorized equipment?
There's you could do motorized, but
I think you're not.
What we're going to do is all foot traffic. Yeah, we're not doing horses. We're not doing, from what the people that I've talked to in that area, and again, that's another huge advantage to being in the network that I am with BHA, is I have friends in all of these states.
Let me ask you about BHA. Let's just say I wanted to do an out west hunt, but I don't want to drop $5,000 on an outfitter. Is being a member of BHA beneficial to somebody to make contacts in Minnesota that might have also contacts outside of Minnesota where, hey, I've been really wanting an elk hunt and I'm 45 years old and my son's 16 and I feel like I'm getting a little old, but I really want to do this. Are there contacts within BHA that can be facilitated through some of these pints that you're talking about, these meetings where you can meet people and learn about that and not be so scared about it?
Absolutely. Do you have time for a story?
Yeah, absolutely.
So
that's why you're here, dude.
I guess my own total anecdote on this. We were sitting at that national rendezvous, and we were going to watch.
Which is where?
This was out in Idaho, or out in Boise.
Okay.
And I started talking with a woman. I knew she was from Wyoming. Didn't really know a whole lot about her, but I knew she belonged to the Wyoming chapter. And just said, you know, I'm thinking about going out to Wyoming with my father-in-law. Used to elk hunt, you know, growing up. Had done it for 30 years, but the rest of his camp got old, and they don't go anymore. They haven't gone for 5 years.
That happens a lot.
I know. And my dad and I have gone out antelope hunting a few times. Never really focused on mule deer, but I'm like, I'd like to do a mule deer hunt out west.
Mm-hmm.
I'm thinking about going to Wyoming. My brother-in-law's never been out west at all, so I'd really like to go out with myself, my dad, my brother-in-law, and my father-in-law.
Mm-hmm.
And this woman flips me her business card, and she's like, call me. I work in that area for Wyoming Wildlife Federation.
So is it fair to say that even if I didn't go, if I was a BHA member in Minnesota and I didn't go to Boise,
yes,
Idaho with you,
yes.
I would still have access to that information if I went to one of the pint meetings,
yeah.
And I ran into you and I was like, hey, man, I couldn't get out to the national meeting, but this is what I really want to do. Are there BHA members like yourself that go to these events that somebody could make contact with?
I've had so many people reach out to me through those type of events. Oh, man, I've always really wanted to do that type of a hunt. Cool. You know what? What state do you want to go to? Let's connect you with Idaho at backcountryhunters.org.
You know
or
somebody
know
who knows somebody. It's almost mafioso.
Yes.
We know
those
a guy in that area.
Yes,
yeah.
Definitely.
Yeah. Who do we know in Boise? Who do we know in New Mexico?
Yeah.
And if you don't know, you'll know somebody that knows.
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay. So I just want everybody to be aware that even if you can't go to these national meetings, these guys here in Minnesota do go to them. So they're doing your heavy lift for you. So if you really want to get involved in a Western hunt, you don't know the contacts, just go to one of the local pint meetings and don't be afraid to ask the question, because these guys are going to flip the business card, and if they don't have it, they're going to know somebody that does. Is that fair enough?
Absolutely. And I guess I want to stress, too, it's not just Western. I plan on hunting. Yeah. I mean, this is nationwide. I plan on hunting Idaho, Arkansas, and Indiana this year with no contacts in any of those states, no private land to go to, and I'm just going to roll the dice and hopefully try and get some contacts in those states. And, yeah, I mean, so it's definitely not just a Western thing.
So you know that if you want to become a member of BHA, you know that some of your local guys are stepping up and going nationally around the country and making contacts for you that you don't have to do. Like he just said, he's going to Arkansas and three other states this fall, so he's going to make contacts for you. And if you want to be a member and show up, just ask,
Just ask.
Sounds like you guys are really, really firm on promoting just excitement about hunting.
Yeah. It's brand new for me, too. So a lot of these things, like, try them. What's the worst that's going to happen? You go out
you don't harvest?
Cool
big deal.
Trip. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, you got a cool hand. Yeah, like, so my brother, he's going out to Colorado with me this year. It's going to be, like, my fifth time. It's his second. He's pretty nervous about going out, and I'm like trying to quell his anxiety. And I'm like, dude, at the end of the day, guess what? We're gonna have a cool camping trip.
Yeah.
That's about all it takes, right?
Just happen to have a bow in our hand.
Yeah, exactly.
Or a gun.
Exactly. And speaking of gear, I want to transition into something else that you do. I want to talk about boots a little bit. Man. I remember starting out as a duck hunter with, like, Hodgman waders and freezing my ass off and not knowing a thing about what insulation, waterproofing, all that meant. As I grew, technology also probably outgrew me faster than I was hunting, and I couldn't afford it. But I think that I've never on this show promoted a piece of gear that I've never used. And I want to tell the listeners right now, I've been an Irish setter guy for about a dozen years, maybe even more. So I want you to maybe talk about a few of the boots that you have, the applications. One thing I want to stress is a lot of people call them shit kickers, mutt boots, whatever you want to call them. They have way more applications than just repelling water. So I want you to start with that set of boot, insulation properties, applications, and let's kind of maybe go down the line a little bit. And we'll put them up on the camera for people to see. But
for sure,
this is the boot that I'm mainly talking about. I use this boot a lot, not only for duck hunting. I use it a lot for pheasant hunting, especially late season. Because snow, burrs, insects won't go down your pant leg and into your socks. And also, if you're dry, you're warm. And these boots, these particular boots, will keep you dry up to a certain point, unless you want to fall into a drainage ditch. But if you're dry, you have a better chance of staying warm. So these boots have more applications than jumping creeks and whatever. So I want everybody to be cognizant that these things aren't just for kicking moon pies down the pasture. That there are scent qualities if you're a bull hunter. There's insulation properties and dry properties with these boots that you're not going to get anywhere else. But they're also a detriment that they're not really walkability-ish. If you want to go 8-10 miles, probably not the boot for you. But if you want to go across a drainage ditch to climb up into a deer stand, these are the boots for you. But that's just my two cents, because I love these boots to death, and I use them a ton. They do take a little bit of breaking in, Just so if anybody has a weak ankle, got to break them in. Other than that, I love them to death, and I'll hand it off and let you kind of go down the line.
So this style is actually brand new this year, called the Mud Trek. We've had the Rutmaster line for a handful of years. It's been a great boot for us. We just wanted to kind of mix it up, bring something new. Like you said, the technologies have changed, and so we wanted to be leading in that market. You can see a couple of differences between the two models that I brought in. We were just talking about insulation. You can see on this model, it's got kind of a hex pattern in the neoprene, and that's so you have the ability to, once you're sitting still, like you said, let's say we hike in, and everybody knows you walk in somewhere and you're going to sweat.
So, for example, for anybody who bull hunts late season, who wears like a heavily insulated gear system, I've advocated, and I do advocate, that you keep like your hip zippers open.
Walk in cold.
And you walk in cold and then warm up after you get in the stand, otherwise you're going to sweat. They're going to be super cold.
Right.
So I'm looking at this boot right now, and I think it's kind of designed in the same way, right?
Yes. So that hex pattern on this boot, on these Mud Treks, is designed to keep you warm in these kind of thicker pockets, but also it's gridded out so your steam or your breathability allows that extra heat to escape when you're doing those kind of hike-ins. The two models that we have here, one is what's called our full-fit model. So very similar to like the kind of traditional muck boot or you know, other styles, kind of loose fitting around the ankle, super easy to slide in, slide out of. If you're familiar with our current Rutmaster line, the only complaint we had about them was, man, they are a bitch to get on. And because they lock around your ankle.
They do.
But that also means when you're going to go and step in a deep hole, and
you're locked in.
Suck this,
you're not
going to
lift
your
foot out, and the boot's in the mud.
So with the model you have, you can see there's a little bit taller rubber here. That's designed as kind of a brush guard, thinking that the athletic fit model, which is going to lock around your ankle, that's for a little bit more of that trucking through, and designed with a little bit more, you know, kicking those cattails through.
If you're a late season pheasant hunter and the slough may not be completely locked up, and but you want to kick it around and this is your
athletic fit with that kind of brush guard that goes all the way up the front.
And it's a lower insulation level; it's a 400, so you can be more active in this boot versus that boot.
And that model is going to come in uninsulated 400 and up to 1,000 grams.
Oh wow! Okay.
And then this one will come in uninsulated 800 and 1,200.
Okay,
so
you got options. you could go super warm to 1,200 here, or you could go active in uninsulated in this model.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
So I just want everybody to be aware that you can have multiple boots for different kind of hunts. You don't have to wear the same boot for every hunt that you go on. And I would encourage people, particularly if you're going out west or out to South Dakota, early season, late season, you know, look, if you're going to be moving feet, if you're going to be moving 2-3 miles a day, your footwear, what's the old mafioso thing? Concrete galoshes, right? You don't want to be trucking around, you know, lifting your feet up and exhausting yourself.
Cement shoes.
Yeah.
Yep.
So cement shoes. Great call. you want to try and pair your boot with your hunt. And I'm not saying go out and buy like 4 pairs of boots just because. There are versatile boots that you can get away with as long as you're careful. But in my opinion, one of these style boots can get you through September through December as long as you're careful about what you do and how you do it. So let's talk a little bit more about some of the other boots you have here. I see you have some high, mids, lows, hiking.
Well,
so you guys aren't just geared for straight up hunting. You guys also have boots that are workman boots, are available for multiple applications.
That's the previous model was called the Rutmaster. I mean, it was designed as a hunt boot, whereas these are the Mud Treks. They're designed for applications outside of just hunting.
Yeah.
People, we realize people are going to go ATVing, kicking around in the garden, you know, mm-hmm. these are going to be washing the truck, you know, whatever.
I got to tell you, I wear these when I go ice fishing and I'm drilling my holes in my ice castle,
yep.
or if I'm drilling them outside, I like to get my auger and just slam it down and pull it up.
Slush it up.
To slush it out. And without these boots on, I get soaked.
Yep.
So having those boots on are, I wear them ice fishing,
yeah.
even. So it's not even... There's multiple applications for them. I want you guys to start thinking about your gear not just for September through October. Let's start thinking about how you're going to use your gear for ice fishing, how you might want to use that rain jacket for turkey hunting. So I think we have a really good line of boots here I want to talk to everybody about as far as not just elk hunting in Idaho.
Yeah.
One of the really... cool boots that I see right here. This is, so I'm a cop, and cops love their gear, right? There are a lot of cops that run these boots right here because they have really good grip. They're very durable, and they also have insulation for winter months. And we have a lot of wear and tear on our feet, kind of like a construction worker. So these boots are... Almost number one. The Iron Rangers are really good in the summer, but in the winter, you'll fall on your ass.
Yeah.
Because there's no grip on the bottom. But these are probably number one, second to that. And can you talk about why somebody would want a boot like this versus a boot like this based on how they hunt? Meaning... are you a tree stand hunter? Are you a stalker? Are you crawling through a mountain?
Right.
What can Irish Setter do for you based on how you hunt? And I want the listeners to really think about how they hunt and why they're choosing their boot.
Yeah, I mean, and I'm a total tightwad when it comes to buying. Like, I'm trying to get the most versatile use out of my gear when I can, as often as I can. However, there are... applications, you know, this boot is built for this type of thing.
Yep.
Or, I mean, I always say boots and optics. Like, if you don't have top boots and optics for the type of thing that you're trying to use, then those can be the biggest make or breaks.
Well, why would you buy a Ferrari and put E85 in it?
Exactly.
You would want to put non-octane in. Why would you buy a $400 Sitka suit and go out there with sub... If your feet are cold, you're miserable. Your hunt's going to suck. You're not going to be in the field, and you're not going to harvest
right.
because you're miserable.
Yep.
Your feet,
as soon as you sit down,
your feet,
you're
and
your
hands.
Oh, I'm worried about trying to stay warm the whole
yep.
time.
It's your feet and your hands.
That's yeah, absolutely. So
right?
yeah, I mean, so Irish Setter, the brand itself was built around the idea of upland hunting. It's
mm-hmm.
named after an upland hunting dog, and
yep.
so this is our upland hunting like flagship boot. It's called the Wing Shooter, and it's virtually unchanged since its inception.
If you guys have grandfathers that have been hunting pheasants and they have a pair of boots in their closet, I guarantee you this is the pair of boots.
I was lucky enough last year to be asked by Pheasants Forever to go out on their corporate partners hunt last year. And you walk into that mudroom and like the floor is just lined. I mean, that's what it was because
yeah.
those guys know their boots. It's designed to be hardcore. It's super waterproof. It's leather. I mean, people that have been doing it a long time, they trust leather. They
yep.
know that it will be the last thing to fail. Some
mm-hmm.
people trust synthetics, or there's, you know, it's resolable. You can, for $100, you can call me in customer service. So that's the other thing. If you call customer service and have a, you know, question or complaint or something about Irish Setter, I'm the guy who picks up the phone. If I'm not the guy...
he'll answer the phone. Literally,
like a real person.
Will.
Like, if
yeah.
I'm not the guy to pick up the phone, it's one of my other coworkers who will, and it's because I'm on the phone with somebody else.
Sure.
And, you know, you can call and say, hey, I'd like to have these resold. I'll send you a shipping label, and you can send me a check or money order, and we'll put a new sole on these.
Is it fair to say that the sole's probably going to wear out before the leather?
Yes.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
I have people
yep.
who every week call, and it's their third, fourth time
yeah.
resoling a pair of boots.
Yep.
It's designed. I mean, people call in and say, well, there's not a whole lot of treading on it. Yeah, it's designed that way. So you're
yeah.
not wearing those cement shoes
yeah.
after, you know, a full day of walking in the field.
Mm-hmm.
It's designed, the tread pattern is built to glide through, tall grasses with a little bit more lugging and grip in the middle without, you know, clogging up with all that kind of mud that you...
So you are going to wear out your sole from time to time, but it's easier to change or repurpose the sole or refurbish the sole than get a whole new pair
right.
of boots.
You're not having to break in a whole new boot again. Yep. It's, you know...
Talk about breaking in. I have a firm belief that... So, for example, my brother fell out of a deer stand, spiral fractured his ankle, and, you know, we're going out to... He did that last year, and he's rehabbing, and we're going out to Colorado, and he's about to buy a new pair of boots, and I was just like, dude, you got to break them in.
Yeah.
And he's like, oh, I'll do it. No, you won't do it out in the field.
Yeah. That's
what is the important about breaking in a boot before you get to where you want to go versus like, hey, I'm in Aberdeen, South Dakota. I'm going to go to Cabela's and buy a new pair of boots.
Well, we were just talking about, you know, why, how poor feet, you know, can ruin the hunt faster than anything.
Yeah.
If you're going to try and get used to a new pair in that field, in that application, you're already putting your feet through rigors that they're not used to, whether that's longer days in the field, different terrain. Last year, I was out on that Colorado hunt at 12,000 feet at a 45-degree incline over deadfall. I can't practice that here in Minnesota.
No.
So I have to try and break in a new pair of boots before I go out there so they're as comfortable as they can possibly be.
So would you recommend if somebody wants to buy a pair of boots that's going to go to Colorado, Idaho, Wyoming, Montana, starting September, October, November, and you want to buy a new pair of boots, buy them now and start hiking around in them?
Sooner the better. Absolutely. I mean, it's not too late. I would definitely do it now as opposed to...
How long do you think it would take to break in a pair of boots? Like, how many steps or hours do...
I try and put things a little bit closer than I probably should just to see how comfortable out of the box they can be. But, so a couple years ago, went up to the BHA rendezvous with a pair of boots that I bought on my way to get on the plane.
Mm-hmm.
Wore them on the plane, wore them out to the bars that night, wore them around the trade shows for all weekend.
Sure.
I think I put roughly 10 miles a day on them,
mm-hmm.
and they were out of the box comfortable. That doesn't happen for everybody.
Sure.
But I would say rough range, and it really kind of depends on your feet.
50,000 steps?
Yeah. I mean, I would say...
If you had to throw a number out there?
Between 10 to 15 miles.
Okay.
I would say. I mean, some people it's super fast.
Active,
right
away. Active miles, not just like walking around the living room miles.
Right.
Like, get out onto a hiking trail mile.
Right. I mean, and make sure that when you buy a new pair of boots, like, sit around and watch television, have dinner in them, you know, squat down into a baseball catcher's stance and make sure that they're comfortable
mm-hmm.
up and down the stairs of your house
sure.
before you go outside and are miserable in them.
And that's why we advocate for anybody who's about to go out west or even right before, I mean, bowl opener is coming up here in like, 3 weeks. Like, if you want to, you should already be practicing your archery, but do it in your full gear and including boots.
Yep.
Because you stand up in that stand and you're... When you go to full draw, you're going to have, okay, my gear is reacting this way. Well, if it's a brand new pair of boots, you might have it might make you stand a little bit differently. So the more you practice in full kit, the better you're going to be in the field. Is that kind of what you're saying?
I mean, I grew up playing hockey, and it was the coaches
real breaking in a pair of skates.
Like,
come on.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I had the weeniest feet growing up because of skates.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, breaking in skates.
I was a wrestler. You could break in a pair of wrestling shoes.
Yeah.
And I know they're basically cloth, but you could break them in, and you could tell the difference when they broke in.
Yeah.
So.
You got to practice how you play.
You do. And perfect practice makes perfect, not just practice. So I'm guilty of it. I go into my backyard, and I just ding, ding, ding. I shoot some arrows, but... You got to get in full guard.
Yeah.
You got to go full kit, particularly if you have a brand new pair of boots that you're going to go out west. Because guess what? You've put a lot of time, money, and energy into a Idaho, Colorado hunt. Why go out there and put something subpar on your feet? That's literally the only vehicle getting you around is your feet.
Or 2-3 miles into the first day.
And now you're hobbled. You're hobbled, and now your hunt is ruined.
Yep.
So your feet, your hands, and your head... Guys, if you want to get a pair of boots, get them now, break them in, follow us on, we've linked them on our Instagram, Facebook. The mix, we'll have it out. Go on there, check out your boots, try and get them in. I want to talk about one more pair of boot here. Well, actually two. We have a lacing style, which I particularly like, which kind of is like a Merrill or Hard Mountain hardware, where it's just basically a twist in, where there's no laces. The laces are there. It's kind of like a lashing system, and you crank them in. Can you want to talk about that and how this goes into this style of boot? It's almost like a mountaineering boot,
yes,
with some insulation,
yep,
and I think that's kind of what it's designed for.
This is my favorite boot in our line, hands down. It's got enough stability that you can help pack out a heavy pack, and it's going to give you that ankle support, but also it's going to be light enough that you can put an all-day miles on them.
Mm-hmm.
So the BOA system, for anybody that's not familiar with it, is a cable and dial lacing system. You pop a dial out, it's loose, you pop it back in, and you crank it tight. It's going to evenly distribute the lace throughout your foot, so it's comfortable for...
It's like Velcro for elk hunters.
The way it got big was for... snowmobiling boots,
yeah,
snowboarding boots, because dudes wanted to do this with a full glove on.
Yep.
You know how nice it is to not have to take out? And I realized now being around home that in the winter when it's like 40 and slushy outside, this is my truck starting boot because I never have to drag laces through the slush again.
So a lot of guys that I work with, when we go out in the field, we wear gloves, right?
Right.
And we're used to like shooting our gun with our gloves and all that stuff, but... I couldn't tie my laces to save my life with gloves on. So this style, this, what did you call it?
It's the BOA.
The BOA cable style. This style has been more to the advantage of what we do. And I think we stole it from mountaineers and snowmobilers.
Yeah.
And the application is endless, particularly for people in Minnesota, because guess what? You want to walk outside in your Crocs, or you want to walk outside in a fully insulated boot and just turn a crank. It's really, really beneficial.
The biggest, I guess, fear about that is, again, people...
Is it going to fail?
Died in the world. Yes, exactly. Is the cable lace going to fail?
Yeah.
When we brought this boot to
what
market...
What happens if it does?
So when we brought this boot to market, we tested 500 pairs.
Mm-hmm.
Of those 500 pairs over the course of a year, I believe we had two failures.
Okay.
This cable lace system, it's kind of like... Gore-Tex, or it's its own entity, it's its own brand. So
mm-hmm.
BOA is a company.
Yep. Yeah.
And if it ever fails, it's got a lifetime warranty on it. So over the course of its life, they'll replace it.
What about the guy who's out in the mountain in Colorado and that fails? What can he do to
fix it? If it fails, there's a little crimp point on here.
Yep.
And you can slide that around to, let's say it splits here. You can slide
that, lash it down,
lace around, and crimp it there, and that's going to keep you going for the rest of the day or the hunt or whatever.
Sure.
until you can get back to society.
So if it totally failed, like catastrophically, could a guy get back to camp? And does it come with like a backup lashing system?
I mean, you'd have to just ask them.
Would you
they'll
just
send
have
it to you
have,
free?
Okay.
They'll say, hey, where do you want me to send a cable lace system to? And they'll send it to you.
But one failure out of 500
yeah,
over the
right.
course
two
of
the course of the year.
Two
yeah.
over the course of the year. I run this system, this lashing system on my Merrills. It's never failed on me.
Yeah.
And I put a lot of
put
a lot of miles on
put
on
through the ringer. It's
yep.
been through snowmobile trips to the UP, and you just douse the snowmobile and just bury it.
Yeah.
And that's the boot I was wearing.
And that's what you can just crank and uncrank to
yep.
get in and out of it.
Yep.
That's awesome, dude. I really appreciate you coming on and talking about this, mainly BHA. But one of the last things, because we were talking about like just being an environmentalist and not just hunting and fishing and bullets and hooks, you guys do have a really good hiking boot, like a really good one. So if you like to just go to BWCA to hike around, go down the Gunflint Trail, and you're looking for a really good boot to get you through there with the support, I want you to talk about this one, but we're not just advocating for hunters. You want a canoe, you want a kayak. You guys have a lot of applications for boots and footwear. This shoe, essentially, it's really super light.
2 pounds, 4 ounces for the pair.
Yeah, that's super light. And there's waterproof ability in here.
Yep.
So you want to talk about this one? Because I think this would be the most versatile for, like, an early season pheasant hunter. Like, you could be in a goose blind early September, yep, and you wouldn't get too hot in it.
Well, it's the same thing with the way, yep, that tread pattern is designed. It's designed to kind of glide through. You're, mm-hmm, going to have a little bit more traction on the inside, but it's still super lightweight. Like, I describe this as, like, the ideal antelope hunting boot. Or, like you said, the common everyday kind of day hike type person.
Yep.
Yes, this model is in camouflage, but it also comes in non-camouflage. We realize that there's a lot of folks out there who don't want a camo boot or don't feel like they need it. You're going to see this much of the boot anyways.
Yep.
So some people don't really care that much. That's why we've got the Ravine line in non-camouflage as well.
That goes a little bit higher if you,
right,
need it.
Yep. Yep. But so this is kind of built on what we would call like a trail running type boot. This orange pad in the middle, it's kind of similar to what you would find in like a marathon runner.
I feel like, so I feel like I could run 5 miles in,
yeah,
that.
Exactly.
In that,
like, the original ad for this boot is the dude on like track stops.
Yeah.
Like starting out.
It's like an oversized, remember back in the day, the Reebok or whatever pump?
Yes.
It's like a, it's right, like a big high top, but with grip.
Yeah.
So,
yeah,
and some waterproof.
It's, I mean, that orange
component
pad is,
yeah,
the same high rebound material that you would find
super
in a basketball shoe,
yep,
or like you said, a hardcore running shoe. Just a little bit more aggressive tread, heavier density rubber, so it's gonna hold up. I had a guy call me with an older pair, and he was hunting in Western, the Big Island of Hawaii,
mm-hmm,
which for anybody who's familiar is like all volcano rock. And well, my brother happens to live in Hawaii. And so I knew that I asked him, I was, yeah, like, so where are you hunting in on the Big Island? The Hilo side or the Kona side? And he kind of like stops and like, the hell does this dude know?
Yeah.
Like, tell me more.
Yeah.
And so I was like, well, if you're hunting on the Kona side, it's going to be like, it's going to wear out faster because you're hunting in volcano rock. He's like, all right, dude knows what he's talking about.
Yeah.
Because on the, if you're on the Hilo side, you're going to get 136 inches of rain versus 36 inches of rain,
sure,
a year. And he's,
sure,
like, I'm sold, man. This guy,
yeah,
knows his stuff.
Well, I think a lot of it
is going to hold up against that kind of wear.
Yeah, and obviously you have knowledge about like places in the world, but I think that the boots are versatile whether you're in Hawaii, Alaska,
yeah,
Montana, Wyoming, right, antelope hunting, or if you're sitting in a tree stand in northern Minnesota, you guys got the boot for.
There's
you.
Not a one boot fits all for,
no,
any types of hunting.
Absolutely
help,
not.
You know, help us help you get,
yep,
the right kind. That's the fun part of my job,
yep,
is when people call me and say, hey, it's you know, such and such a season. I'm from Alabama, and this is my first elk tag. What kind of boots do I need?
Sure.
Or I'm looking to do a late season goose hunt in Saskatchewan, and what kind of boots? Yes.
Yeah.
Like, let me
and
help
don't
you.
Don't be afraid to say, hey, I'm going to northern Minnesota. I'm going to climb up into a deer stand, and I want my feet to be warm.
Yeah, absolutely.
Like that's totally cool.
Technology in,
yeah,
that
trick
for,
yeah,
that.
Absolutely. You guys have the boot to fit what our listeners are doing. So don't be afraid to be honest when you call up Irish Setter, to be honest about how you're going to hunt. Just be honest about it. They're going to have a boot for you, and you're going to be successful because if your feet are cold, your hands are cold, you're done. Your hunt sucks, and it's not going to be fun, particularly if you're bringing a kid out. Look, if you're bringing your kid out, make sure that they're the most comfortable possible. Buy the best gear that you can afford. Don't buy the most expensive gear.
Break the bank.
Yeah, don't break the bank. Buy the best thing you can afford and be honest about how you're going to hunt. And you know what? Bringing kids out is the best way to get them excited about it. And if you bring a kid out there and they're cold and miserable, they're not going to want to go. And it's going to be miserable for dad,
that's
uncle, cousin. Yeah,
exactly.
So having a good pair of boots is probably the first and foremost, and a good pair of mittens. So if Irish Setter made mittens, I'd buy them. But I currently buy their boots. They're pretty awesome. I want to give a shout out here for BHA. Check out our Facebook, our Instagram, our radio network, and join if you can. If you can't, show up for a pint and a conversation. They're here to help. They're not here to take your money. Have a great weekend. We're going to probably sign off here unless you have anything else, Scott.
Not a thing, but you know what? Next week, we are going to have Mitch Elson-Peter will be in studio. We'll listen to some of his music, and we're going to circle back around and do it again next week. Yeah. Tune in. We'll be live from the Mixed Radio Network, The Grind, Field, from Field to Freezer, Sunday night, 7 o'clock. Mitch Elson-Peter. We'll circle back around and do it again next time. See y'all.
Looking at
good
work,
man.
Yeah.
If
I can make a show,
I always show up like 2 minutes before the show. And,